Hey everybody, so I am a huge fan of Europa. Europa is an amazing publisher, a smaller publisher that puts out fantastic books. Books translated, not translated, books from all over the world, and I am a huge fan. And lately they have been sending me quite a few books, so I have been diving in, and I need to make sure that these six Europa editions wind up on your TBR. So let's get started. Hi everybody and welcome back to my channel. It's Russell with Ink and Paper Blog. How are you doing today? As always, I hope you're happy, I hope you're healthy, I hope you're safe, and of course, I hope you're reading an amazing book or two or three or four. As I said in my last video, I am traveling this week, so I'm actually filming this video in advance to make sure that I get you some content, and just to talk about amazing, amazing books. That's what I'm here for today. Europa is just a fantastic, fantastic publisher. Really, I mean, they are known for the Ferrante novels, the Neapolitan novels, really put them on the map, but they have so many more books, so many amazing titles that are just fantastic. They actually, I think that, yes, I'm pretty sure, didn't they publish Damon Golgot's book that just won the Booker a couple years ago? I think they did, and I think that's all of the editions I have of his books are all Europa. So they are fantastic, let's just say that. And lately they have been sending me some additional books, more books than usual. I actually have six of them that have come in the last months that I have been meaning to make sure wind up on your TBR. So get out your pen, get out your paper, get out your Goodreads, get out however you keep track of that TBR. If you are so able, please get these books from your local independent bookstore. I think you can actually order them from Europa as well directly. I get most of mine from the books Booksmith in San Francisco. They have, or Green Apple Books on the Park. They have fantastic Europa edition selections at both of those bookstores in San Francisco if you are looking. So highly recommend that. But if you're a library user, these may be a little bit more difficult to get through your library, but try, make them, order them, because they're fantastic. So I do want to start with a caveat. We do have a lot of, I think all of these are actually translated this time. So I will do my best with the names and I apologize in advance. And I will definitely try to get all of the the translators named in this. So all of these Europa, I'm not going to say it again. But let's start with Veronica Olmi's Daughters Beyond Command. This is translated from the French by Alison Anderson, phenomenal, phenomenal translator. This is the story of three sisters between May 1968 through May 1981. There's a very pivotal election that occurs on May 10th, 1981. And it follows sort of these three sisters through this time period of upheaval in France, three very different women. It's a family story, a family saga. And gosh, the cover of this is just absolutely gorgeous. So this one is one of those ones, if you want to dive into sort of that family drama over a whole entire period of time, you know we all love them. So that's Veronica Olmi's Daughters Beyond Command, again, translated by Alison Anderson. Okay. Next up on the list is one of the names I'm going to have the hardest time with, but this is Opium and Other Stories by Geza Csath, and I apologize, I am terrible, terrible there. I believe he was born in Hungary, so my Hungarian. That's terrible. But this is translated by, translated by Jascha Kessler and Charlotte Rogers, with a biographical note by Mariana D. Burmum. I will say that I don't know much about him, but the insert says that he committed suicide after he killed his wife. So very dark life, unfortunately, for this author. And these stories, they're very dark. They're very contemplative. They're very... I think I love the way it actually explains it. And they say the stories possess clarity, insight, and at times are remarkable for their shock value. They are unsettling and gothic, surreal and dreamlike, and each in its own way pierces the veil of normality to reveal a truth to which the author himself ultimately succumbed. So, one, this, God, Europa always does such a fine job on covers. But yeah, so if you're looking for a collection of short stories, I had not heard of him. The inside says that he is one of Eastern Europe's most visionary authors. So good way to dive into someone you may not have heard of. So that's Geza Csath, I'm sorry, I know I'm saying that wrong. Opium and Other Stories, translated from the Hungarian by Jascha Kessler and Charlotte Rogers. Okay, now we're going to go to Japan. One of my friends on Instagram actually picked this book up after the video that I hauled it in. And what she put was that it was a crazy ride for her. And she wants people to read it to talk to her about it. So I'm going to tell you about Love at 6,000 Degrees by Maki Kashimada, translated from the Japanese by... Second, please. Hayden Trowell. And this book is really interesting. So this is about a woman who becomes sort of, obsessed is not right, the right word, but I'm trying to think about haunted. That's the word I think they use. Haunted by the bombing of Nagasaki and sort of this idea of this mushroom cloud in the distance. And she leaves her husband and she leaves her son and she travels to Nagasaki and she winds up having an affair with a half Russian, half Japanese man, I believe. Yes. And sort of it's this internal dialogue regarding those sort of factors, family, leaving family, obligations, and the destruction that the nuclear weapon had on Nagasaki itself. So there you go. Love at 6,000 Degrees by Maki Kashimada, translated from the Japanese by Hayden Trowell. Okay. See, I'm going all over the world today. So, because I think next we go to Italy. So let's go to Italy with Lesser Islands by Lorenza Pieri. And this is translated from the Italian by, this has a lot of translators. Peter DiGiovanni, William Greer, Donatella Molucci, Jenna Menta, Christopher Panaguay, and Kira Ross. So all of those people were involved in the translation of this novel. And what I love about this one, I'm going to actually use this book, but this takes place over four decades on this island in Tuscany called Giglio. And it is a portrait of a family of two sisters and sort of an observation of Italian society and culture as it goes through a change. So it says, the older sister, the combative mother, the hedonistic father, the grandmother, veteran of the resistance, and a wild young man who steals her heart to find her own place in the world. Teresa must put a distance between herself and all of these vivid, powerful figures in her life. But soon enough, she'll also have to reckon with the island itself, with the prejudices of its inhabitants and the long shadow cast by Italy's dark history. So I think that sounds great. I think that, I just think, you know, I love these family stories over decades or people changing over decades. I just think it's such a powerful story. So again, this is Lorenza Pieri, Lesser Islands, translated. Let me get that list. I like to give them all. There's just quite a few on this one. Peter DiGiovanni, William Greer, Donatella Molucci, Jenna Menta, Christopher Panaguaya, and that's terribly said, and Kira Ross. So you should get your hands on that. I also love that cover a lot. I would take this as a painting for my house. I think it's beautiful. Okay, now we're going to go to something translated from Turkish, which I don't think I've ever talked about anything translated from Turkish on my channel. No, that's not true. That's not true. The guy who wrote Snow, whose name is totally, totally going out of my brain. But Dying is Easier Than Loving by Ahmet Altan. This is translated from the Turkish by Brendan Freely. And this is book three in the Autumn Quartet. So, and when I say Autumn, I'm probably sounding like I'm saying Autumn, and that's wrong. It's the O-T-T. O-M-A-N that I'm trying to say. And this is a saga. Look at this is a thing. It takes place over decades. This is this is leading up to World War I. And it's sort of steeped in the events that sort of created and shaped 20th century Turkey. And it says, against the background of the war against the Bulgarian army and the coup that resulted in the nation's one-party rule, a tormented, obsessive love affair unfolds between Nizam, the son of Hikmet Bey, and a Russian pianist, Anya. And yeah, so I need to get the rest of them, clearly, but thank you, Europa, for sending this one to me. I actually started it and I was like, you know what, Russell, you need to go buy the other ones before so it all makes sense. So, but you know there's two more. You know that this cover is fantastic and we all should be reading more literature from countries that we don't read a lot of books from. So that's Dying and Is Easier Than Loving by Ahmet Altan, translated from the Turkish by Brendan Freely. Okay, last but not least is a book that popped up on my Instagram. And once I heard about it, I was so excited and I hearted and told Europa, I can't wait to get my hands on this one. And so they kindly sent me this finished copy of The Postcard by Anne Berest. This is translated from the French by Tina Kover. Love Tina Kover. I can totally see her book. It was nominated for all those awards. Oh, it's driving me crazy. It was set in Iran. It was translated from French as well. Help me out in the comments below. You know what? Tip of my tongue. But what about this book? So this is another family story. All these great family stories. But this is about a family. Let me see if I can... It's about a family that was devastated by the Holocaust. They lost members of their family in the Holocaust, and now they're in France. And it's 2003, and the holiday cards are coming in, and all of a sudden the family, the Berest family, is at home in Paris, and they get a postcard. And on the back of the postcard is the names of them, the maternal grandparents and their children that they lost in the Holocaust. And... about 10 years later, 15 years later, after the postcard arrives, the Annie, who is one of the family members, decides that she wants to figure out who sent this postcard and why. And so she goes on to investigate. And here, this is hilarious. Aided by her chain-smoking mother, friends, a private detective, a graphologist, and many others, she sets out to discover the fate of the Rabanovich family. What emerges is a moving saga that shatters long-held certainties about Annie's family and her country and herself. So, I think that sounds fantastic. This won all sorts of prizes and is, I guess, a beloved French novel now in English. So, that's The Postcard by Anne Berest. This is translated from the French by Tina Kover. And yeah, you can get your hands on every single book I talked about. They are all out. There's more out there. I just go and spend some time on the Europa website looking at the amazing, amazing books that they have out. This is just a small stack. I totally promise. Whatever you are looking for, you will find stuff. Highly, highly, highly recommend. So as always, if you're a return subscriber, I could not do this without you. You are the reason that I do it every single day. If you are new to my channel, I hope you subscribe and I hope you find a book that you like, one or two or three or four, excuse me. And as always, I encourage you to read globally, shop locally, and until next time, I wish you happy reading. Bye, everybody.